Scotland has an ambition to be the best place in the world to grow up, so that children are loved, safe and respected, and realise their full potential.
Promise one, children must be listened to and be appropriately involved in decisions about their care.
In October 2016, the First Minister announced an independent root and branch review of care, driven by those with experience of care.
Promise two, where children are safe and feel loved in their families, they must stay.
The care review listened to over 5,500 stories from care experienced children and adults, families, and the paid and unpaid workforce.
Promise three, where living with their family is not possible, children must stay with their brothers and sisters where safe to do so, and belong to a loving home.
The review published its conclusions in 2020.
Four, the children Scotland cares for must be actively supported to develop relationships with people in the workforce and wider community, who in turn must be supported to listen and be compassionate in their care.
The Scottish Government pledged commitment to its fivefold, the promise.
Five, children, families and the workforce must be supported by a system that is there when it's needed.
The review states that it's vital our most vulnerable children feel loved.
It's assurance, it's comfort, it's tenderness, seeing me, being there, seeing no sometimes, congratulations, 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 congrat That's what love is.
But how do you do
that?
How do you legislate?
Lisa, 22, a care experienced person. Something the Scottish Government uses all the time, right, is we want Scotland to be the best place in the world for children to grow up. To me, like, that's so subjective. What does that even mean? What does that mean for the clear class divides that still exist in Scotland? There's people who will have that nuclear family, will have middle class or upper class parents who can give them every single thing that they want in life, and they would have, on paper, the best childhood. Or you could have families with really clear issues, which is what my family was. There were really clear issues, things that could have been spotted, and had there been the opportunity for my dad and his four children to grow and be a family, then we could have had that best childhood. My dad, a single parent, shouldn't have had to work so much. He worked three jobs to support us. He wasn't a bad dad, he was just set up to fail. He should have been given support. There's so many things that led to the situations that we ended up in that could have been fixed and prevented the things that we had to go through. When problems presented themselves, he should have been supported to work through them. Why are we okay with people's children being taken away from them? Why is it always poor people's children who are taken away? I just watched The Crown, right? And I see someone who is so different to me, so privileged, like one of the most important people on earth, Prince Charles. And he's also like a care experienced person. He wasn't raised by his parents. He was sent away to a really harsh boarding school, and he wasn't allowed to make choices or to live the life he wants. I can live the life I want to now. I have freedoms now. I think maybe there's lots of middle class kids living lives like mine and going through some of the things that me and my brothers and sister went through, but because their parents work and they live in a nice house, they have this veneer of respectability. They never come into the radar of social services. Money insulates people. You know, I think we're going to look back in 50 years' time, maybe in Scotland, and feel the same way about what we've done to poor people's children as the Canadians do about how they treated First Nations children, or the Australians about their native people's kids. It's like ethnic cleansing or something, but it's not about ethnicity. It's about class. Why are we taking poor people's kids away so often?
David, 60, is a member of the Independent Care Review Scotland. No social worker starts off by saying, I'm going to make life really difficult for people in care.
What if social workers were much more careful about how they spoke about children and young people?
They just become, you know. They're taken over by the system and the system just happens like that, so then we can all just blame the system.
What if social workers were more careful about the language that they use about them and their families and the case notes and reports that they write and present?
So,
and it's not just social workers. The police, criminal justice, teachers, everyone who works with a vulnerable child.
What the Care Review did was click into the notion that what we are doing right now is wrong. Early on, we realised we don't really have a care system.
What if children weren't just removed from the families, but families were supported to love and nurture their children?
We have a child protection system, and that's an entirely different thing to a care system.
What if social workers were allowed to do their jobs?
Like when I was working with street gangs in Glasgow, so much comes back to poverty.
What if we spent more money on reducing abject poverty and inequality, and less on sending people to prison and putting kids in care?
There's a fabulous quote from a Jesuit priest named Gregory Boyle, who runs the largest gang intervention program in the world in Los Angeles. It's called Homeboy Industries. And he says, rather than criticise the poor and how they carry their burden, we should be standing back in awe that they can carry it at all.
What if solutions for working class people were always decided for them by middle class people?
We take kids away from their families, remove them from the risk, but do nothing about the risk. Do nothing at all about the risk. We leave it, because it's easy to leave it.
What if social workers didn't have so many cases they could spend real time with
housing,
all their children
education,
and families?
Addiction services,
what if all
social
local authorities
and social security
across Scotland
could all get around
to
the one vulnerable family
to get the
and keep them together?
Same services instead of making up their own rules within the rules?
What makes it difficult? Systems. Systems love complications, and they love them. Why? Because it's people who are in them. It's people. The answer to every question and every problem is people.
Well,
what
if
children
are
not like these?
Where
are these
people?
These are the people
who are not like these.
We didn't know them around. We wanted to form these strong attachments to them.
What you have here is a wicked problem. Do you know what a wicked problem is? It's a problem that is difficult or impossible to solve because there is no single solution to the problem.
What if everything wasn't just a bit cuts?
Wicked doesn't mean evil. It means that there is a resistance to change.
What if the people of Scotland really cared about Scotland's care system?
So, how will we fix the system that's supposed to be about care in Scotland?
What if we started thinking of those kids as our kids?
It'll change one person at a time.
What if we all realised it takes a whole village to raise a child?
How will we know we're making a difference?
Well, what if we could say love, and do love, and make our most vulnerable kids genuinely feel loved?
Well, I think we'll make the difference when? Well, when we can use the word love in Scotland's care system. When we can say love and do love in all our public services. Then we'll be making a difference. And remember, I'm a former polis saying all this stuff.
John Paul, 22, a care experienced person. More could have been done to keep me with my family. Maybe they should have got me some counselling, looked into the mental health side of me and helped me feel a bit better about myself. I was taken into care when I was in primary six. They put it down to my weight. It came under neglect. I was overweight because food was an addiction. Why was it an addiction? My dad wasn't on the scene.
My mum was a bad epileptic at the time, and she had a hard time, to say the least. My mum was married, divorced, and buried her first child before she was 21. She'd been through a lot of trauma in her life. She didn't have very much money coming in, and sometimes the government would stop her disability allowance for some reason, or it just wouldn't be paid in, and she'd be left looking after us on very little. Then, she had my brother's behaviours to cope with, always creating trouble and bringing it to my mum's door. We had people literally kick the door in, people throwing stuff at our windows, big gangsters in the east end of Glasgow coming to the door and shouting at my mum, people driving cars towards us as if they were going to knock us down, then pulling away. I was scared. Totally scared. So I couldn't control any of that, but I could control what I was eating. Instead of being anorexic, I was like, I'm going to excessively eat. I'm going to eat loads. So food became an addiction. Mum tried her best. She used to put locks on the kitchen door, and I would do anything I could to bust the lock. Mum did a lot for me, and in many ways, I papped her off. Me and my mum fell out the night before. And my mum said, just as well, social worker coming tomorrow, I'll be telling them what you're doing. And I was like, whatever, and went to my bed. The next morning, social work came. And they said to my mum, if you don't give us him, we'll take you to court and we'll take him anyway. And my mum said, you can't do that. And they said, aye, we can. So they made my mum sign a voluntary care order. Mum came in and said, look, you're going to have to go and stay somewhere else for a bit. I was crying. As a kid, I didn't understand what was going on. I packed, we walked downstairs, got into the car, and that was it. I was meant to be in care for 2 weeks. I left care 8.5 years later.
James, 70, a panel member in the children's hearing system.
Alex,
30, a care experienced person.
People within the system have been complaining for a long time. But rather than trying to seriously address it, people in my situation have thought, well, this is better than nothing.
I gave an interview to a newspaper last year about my story. And I said, we're going to look back in 100 years and realise that all we were doing was just taking poor children away from their families. You know?
I'd say in my experience, 90-odd% of kids coming to the children's panel are from a background of poverty.
It's interesting trying to work out what class means now.
Poor housing.
Is it the food you eat?
Lack of employment.
Is it where you shop? Is it the clothes you wear? Education? What you do for a living? I was born in a scheme in North Glasgow in 1990.
In the 60s. A lot of things are very similar now to then. I think in all those areas where huge inequality existed back then, financial, educational, careers, it's still the same.
I'm not a fan of Ken Loach because I don't think there's enough joy in his stuff. Throwing the couch cushions off and pretending the floor's lava and jumping across them. All the wee moments of making your own joy because of the sort of poverty that you're in.
There was poverty in Glasgow City where we first lived, but the problem with these schemes was that the council was disrupting close-knit communities, resettling them in these places where there no connections, no shops. Desolate. But it was exciting to move in because there was an inside toilet. Grandeur!
My mum confided in me a lot as a child. She took me aside at the age of 6 and was like, we're really skint this year, I don't know what we're going to do for Christmas. And I was like, does Santa not bring Christmas? And she's like, there is no Santa.
But what there was back then was community.
One Christmas Eve, I was about 10. The Christmas before we were taken into care. I went down the Barras with £40 to try and buy my brothers and sisters presents.
Every weekend for a month, I remember all the dads turned up and cleared up the building site and the fields behind the houses, littered with rubbish.
That year my mum hadn't really got anything for Christmas. Some Christmases she did really well, but this year she was really skint, so she gave me her last £40 and I went up the Barras with my brother Martin, who's the next oldest to me in age.
They made a football pitch for us. I still remember that to this day. How fantastic this pitch was. How proud we all were of our dads for doing it for us.
We were there till about 10 o'clock at night. So I picked up like a doll for each of my wee sisters and some sweeties and stuff. And I picked up a remote control car for my weeest brother.
And that community must still be there today, helping each other out. I didn't have the emotional poverty that some kids had and have, because I had very loving and attentive parents.
And on the good Christmases, my mum used to get us a Bruins or an O'Reilly album, so like, I got one of those each. And as far as Martin was concerned, we were going to have one or the other of those each. And then I picked up some socks and wee bits and bobs for stockings and stuff.
And I thought when I was wee that kids I was friendly with were just experiencing the same as me, because that's what you do when you're little.
So we got home and Martin and the other kids went to bed. And I was wrapping up stuff and I just wrapped up some socks for myself and gave Martin both the albums.
But it turns out that wasn't the case. I have a photograph of me in primary school, I'm about 6 or 7. I can still remember all the faces and quite a lot of the names of those kids. My best friend who was stabbed to death in a gang fight. And also about 6 or 7 more of those kids who had died, and not of natural causes, but of addictions and violence. And it made me think.
My girlfriend thinks that's a tragic story. I don't. Well, it is. It's not.
How did I get from a background,
how did I get from a background in care to what
other
people
see
as success?
That's a hard one.
It's a hard one.
It took me a long time. It took me until I was about 50 to realise I had merit and value and worth.
People reinforce that
the
idea
education
that
I was
certain
offered
things
was the one
aren't
that was offered
for
to
you
someone
if
from
you come
a
from a
background.
Poor background. And I don't think they necessarily mean it.
There was an expectation that I would leave school and get a manual job at best. Not that I would ever go to university. That wasn't for people like me.
I guess I was always quite driven. Yeah. I think it's like a fear thing, initially. Fear of not having dinner, you know? To fear of turning out like the people around me. To fear of not being successful, like...
I was lucky. I met people who helped me. They saw who I was and what I could do and helped.
And I think a lot of people would watch daytime TV and stuff and see people going off on all these holidays and stuff and see it as entertainment. But I would see that as aspirational. I was like, I want to do that. And I want my brothers and sisters to do that too.
I remember always thinking I was a fraud.
So, like, I really threw myself into trying to make myself a success for that. But also, like, trying to feed my brothers and sisters.
And that's a bit coming from a background where you don't feel you're entitled to exercise authority and power and you can take control and take responsibility because you're capable.
And my brothers and sisters are doing well too.
I've had help and support and I want to pass that on somehow if I can.
And I think we're all doing different jobs that happen to be seen as, if you're doing these, then you're successful.
Because until we all start getting involved in the lives of our most vulnerable kids, nothing's going to change, is it?
Now, I know that seems to be an unusual story for a bunch of kids that came from care. But that's us.
Charlene, 17, a care experienced person.
Lisa, 22, a care experienced person.
Ruth, 27, a social worker.
When I look at what happened to us, to me it could have been avoided if someone somewhere had spotted what was going on in my house.
I've got children whose lives are not good enough. And I know that they're not good enough, or rather not the life that I would want for my own children. But they're not going to die. So that's okay, we don't intervene. Apart from the children who have on a caseload who have really good foster carers, none of the others have a good quality of life. And there's not a huge amount that I can do or I am allowed to do, and that is really hard.
It wasn't very nice at all living where I lived.
Like, we talk about intergenerational cycles of caring families. My mum left when I was 2, I think. Hearing what my mum's life was like, she had a really horrible relationship with her father, experienced abuse in her own life, and then was taken into care.
There was a lot of drugs.
It's not possible to make every child's life perfect.
And she really struggled after leaving care and fell into struggles with alcohol and drug use and relationships with abusive partners, all of which I believe were really well recorded.
A lot of people were getting murdered and stabbed near our house. I remember those things happening.
There are cases where the parents are doing okay. They're not brilliant, but they're doing just enough.
I just wonder why when she left and my dad was left with 4 kids on his own, why did no one flag this up? I was still young enough to have a health visitor and was still having regular checkups, and so why did no one notice?
And by and large, children are better off living with their parents.
I came into care when I was 6.
And I know that by removing that child, it will be really disruptive. It will be too traumatic.
Social services, health, the courts, all of these were involved with my family over a really long period of time. How did everyone miss what was happening?
I've got this family of three. They live with their mum. She uses heroin. She is not a brill mum, but I have moved them into kinship care three times.
My dad's sister-in-law came to the house and smashed the place up. All the windows. She got ladders and she came up to the bedroom where me and my sisters were and put a knife to her throats.
Every time the mum turns it around and they go back and then it just disintegrates all over again. And if I find that exhausting, how do they find it? What is it like for the children?
The social workers started coming after that.
My stepmum physically and psychologically abused us, and she emotionally, financially and psychologically abused my dad. And then one of my stepbrothers was sexually abusing us, but we were too scared to say anything to anyone. Why didn't the school notice?
And as well as that, my mum starved me. I can't remember how long for. She only did this to me. I don't know why.
My oldest brother was taken into care when I was 8.
There's a couple of reasons why I am not going to accommodate them. The oldest two are now too old.
Then my sister was taken into care, and then my next oldest brother.
She had mental health issues. She used to go off on one. Lots of arguments.
I was watching my stepmother get rid of my brothers and sister one by one right before my eyes.
We are throwing lots and lots of support at this mum to avoid taking the littlest one into care.
How did it take 7 more years before anyone paid attention to what was happening to me?
And then one of the days, me and my mum went to Asda. One minute she was nice to me and then she just disappeared. She just left me there. I just turned round and she wasn't there. She didn't do that to any of my sisters or my brother, just me. The police came and took me back home to my mum.
Partly because we can keep things just good enough, and partly because the last time we put them into care, the littlest one was so traumatised, and I just don't want to do that to them again.
I was taken into care when I was 15.
2 days after that, I was told I was being taken into care.
I just feel for them. Their mum isn't the worst. She does love them.
Why, for 8 whole years, did nobody look more deeply into that house and ask what the hell was going on? Stephanie, a worker in a private sector children's residential home.
John Ball, 22, a care experienced person.
I work for a private sector residential care provider.
I grew up in care in residential homes with private care providers.
This organisation works with children with severe trauma and behavioural issues stemming from that. We have 6 kids in the unit. The kids are great and I do love the job, but there are so many things which don't work, it's so frustrating.
There's a new generation and there's an old generation within the care sector.
I was living in Australia for a few years and I worked for an organisation there called Safe Places for Children and trained with them in trauma centred practice and attachment theory. That was interesting because over there they have an idea of looking after other people's children, which is a bit different after their whole stolen generation thing. And the Australian model just seems to be a bit more mindful about the big picture.
The old generation pretended that they loved you and pretended that they were there to help you in that, but it was fake.
It tries to keep that core family unit intact, or at least in contact. And since starting this job in Scotland, that's not something I've seen a lot of here.
However, I do feel like some of the staff members who looked after me in the residential homes I was in did love me.
My frustrations are that we have so many things, we have so many reports to write, so much pressure day to day that staff don't have the time to spend with or the headspace for the young people.
Well, you've got Caroline, for example.
Then there's another darker side. It can become a breeding ground for people who can take advantage of these really vulnerable kids.
Caroline, to be fair, was one of the first staff members to have told me no, and to have told me no frequently, and I used to get mad at her.
There are members of staff who will live for a kid having a meltdown so that they can step in and perform a safe hold. That's physically restraining a kid who's out of control, so they look like a hero.
And I remember one time, she annoyed me that much, and she was walking out after a handover, and I was watering the flowers with a hose, and she said to me, "See you tomorrow, JP, in a better mood."
It's really ego-driven, it's not about keeping the kid safe at all.
And I thought, fuck it. And I just soaked her down. And she was trying to get in the car and I was laughing at it.
Don't get me wrong, there are some excellent staff too. The problem is in the private sector, people can just walk into this job from anywhere with no experience.
And I felt really bad for that afterwards.
And sometimes that's a really good thing, because they can come in and they want to understand, but sometimes they come in with this crowd control, us against them attitude with the kids. They form like a gang. That's how the kids see it. The adult gang against the child gang.
But she went home and her family's like, "You're all drenched, what happened?" And she's like, "Oh, John Paul had a bit of a fit today." And it was like, laughing. "Oh, John Paul, what's he like?"
And we do have to do training in things like trauma and attachment, but no one ever checks that you are actually applying this stuff on a day-to-day basis.
I knew I loved Caroline, but I didn't realise until maybe a couple of years ago about how much she really does love me.
The vision for the organisation, the slogan that it uses to sell itself to local authorities in the care market, and what it charges thousands of pounds for, is not being met.
And she'll tell me that now because we're not in the care setting. Because in the care setting, you can't really tell a young person you love them because it's seen as unprofessional.
Why do I stay? I stay because I genuinely love working with the kids.
And then there's Jim.
I developed a really strong relationship with one of the boys we looked after, Jack.
Jim and I just hit it off within hours of him coming into the unit as a new manager. My dad wasn't on the scene and I looked up to Jim as a father figure.
He smashed everything. He would go from here to here in seconds. And he was put in a safe hold in our unit many times.
Oh, and there were some cases where I thought he was being a complete and utter knob to me. But now I understand that as love.
I never did that. Because he was just a tiny wee boy.
Jim was a bodybuilder himself. I mean, he met me, he saw how overweight I was. But instead of trying to put me on a diet like all the other homes had done, with no success, by the way, he wrapped a whole plan around me.
And so I just used to grab him and hug him when he was kicking off.
He got me a personal trainer.
And it always worked.
Got me lifting weights.
So I fought tooth and nail with social work to be a named person on Jack's care plan as he moved on.
Got me trained up in nutrition and stuff.
And they should have never moved him on, but he was high tariff being looked after in this organisation, which costs a local authority a fortune. And like, cuts in that, you know?
Well, he motivated me. And then I started winning powerlifting competitions and titles, and my whole life changed for the better.
I see him once or twice a month for contact still. We have a different relationship now to caregiver and service user.
And his help is one of the reasons why I am where I am and who I am today. And I don't think he could have done that and wanted to do that if he didn't love the person that I am.
Kids need to know
somebody loves you. You need to know that somebody loves you. It's a feeling. Love was a feeling before it was a word. You don't have to believe it. You can feel it.
Charlene, 17, a care experienced person. It's quite hard to explain. Let me think. I now know what love and care is since I now live with people who love and care about me. Love means protected, comfort, trust, safe. Now I feel like I have people next to me. I have a house, I have food, I can trust my foster carers. I have a key to the house, I'm free to come and go as I want, and I can lock the door to strangers. They comfort me. They hug me, kiss me, let me talk to them about stuff when I'm upset, angry, annoyed. I know what they're feeling, and they can do the same with me. They can sometimes even see what I'm feeling before I even need to say it, because they're watching over me. Physically, I feel safe. I know they're not going to hurt me. They know what I like, and they give me things, like presents and stuff. They talk to me about things that matter to me. They remember stuff about me, good memories, my birthday, important things I need to do, important things that have happened to me, and they smile at me. And that's what being loved is.
Thank you.
social worker.
Helen, 50s, former local authority chief social work officer. The further you go up the chain of social work, the more conversation you have to have about money, delivery, and cuts.
I think when the job of social worker is portrayed on TV, it's portrayed really badly. I mean, like, my first memory is of Elaine the Pain on Tracy Beaker, and I remember thinking, why on earth would anyone do that job? And now, 20 years later...
I've worked in the public sector for over 30 years, and one of the things that I won't miss is having to sit in front of local councillors and talk about value for money.
A couple of weeks ago, I had to spend an afternoon in the park, in the cold, with a woman who had threatened to kill me the day before. And I just thought, this is not fun. You can't get it right as a social worker. You're criticised for not doing or doing. There was a case this week on the news about a teenage girl who had been murdered by her uncle, and the social worker had apparently told her it was okay to live there, and all the comments on social media were like, okay, social workers.
The councillors say, you're overspending your budget again.
And one of my friends was telling me this week that he was really traumatised by a social worker as a child because he had this bruising that had been caused by something else.
And I'll say, I'm not overspending. The demand for our services has gone up massively, and that costs more money. And the budget has never increased for years.
But social work had thought it was his dad that had been hitting him, and he remembers thinking how terrified he was that he was going to be taken away. And he felt that that was overkill. You just can't win.
I'd say there are all the things that I've had to do this week to keep young people safe. And the councillor says they want more of that, of course. And then I'll say, well, all of this costs money.
I don't always agree with everything that we do.
Of course I'm into base value for money. But in the last 2 decades, everything has become about cuts.
I don't think that everything that we do is effective. I don't think that just throwing services at people is the right answer, because they have to be the right services.
I won't miss that at all.
And some of these private care companies that we work with, I won't mention their names. I don't even understand what it is that they actually do.
So much of the work social workers used to do has been farmed out now to the care market.
Some are brilliant. I am a big fan of some of them.
Private companies are charities who we pay to do the work for us.
But most are just this really general thing, and we are paying them thousands of pounds to deliver it, whatever it is.
It used to be that we social workers knew our communities. We knew how to help people. I worked in some of the most deprived inner city areas for decades. I worked in school projects and family centres where the help was universal. We worked with parents to prevent kids being excluded, to prevent families needing other interventions from social services.
Do I feel that I'm in a valued profession? Absolutely not. Well, I mean, it depends.
It is really hard being a parent. But if you can work with them, you work on relationships, it's important.
In terms of protecting babies with bruises, I think there is value. I think people believe that that is necessary. But I think with older children, based on Daily Mail comments, no.
Why is it important? There was a boy I worked with for a long time on the school's project. His mum had mental health problems, and she was really hard on him. I mean, really hard. And my friend who worked on the project with me, she was walking down the street one day, and this young man shouts, Helen! Helen! And she turns around and he says, oh, sorry, I thought you were Helen. And she says, do you mean Helen who used to work on the school project? And he said, yes. And he said, you're going to tell her that I'm a butcher apprentice, and if it wasn't for her, what you did for me, I'd never be doing the things in my life I'm doing now, because you believed in me.
People have no idea what the job is.
And it's such a shame that all that funding for all those types of prevention projects ended with austerity.
I sometimes feel that with some of my well-educated lefty friends, their understanding of social work in a sense, but When it actually comes down to it, they don't really understand. They don't understand the complexity of how people's lives can fall apart. It can take one thing to tip them over the edge, but there has probably been lots of things building up for a while.
Everything's a bit cuts now. But it's a false economy. Because we've even got more children in care now. Because we're now doing that, not doing that early intervention and prevention. Because that costs money.
Some of it is about individual responsibility, yeah. So much is about parenting as well as poverty.
Poverty doesn't make you a bad parent, but it can make you a struggling parent. And that's where people need help.
Some days I think about the people I work with, you just need to get a grip and sort your lives out, especially when we're throwing lots of services at them and they're just not going to change.
We need to find creative ways to keep families on the edge together, support them to cope.
And other days I feel lots and lots of empathy and realise that they did not choose to be in the situation that they're in.
And not just to cope, but to thrive.
I do really love my job though.
Lisa, 22, a care experienced person.
Alex, 30, a care experienced person.
James, 70, a panel member of the Children's Hearing System.
I just got my care records back a while ago.
And do you know those Have Your Say forms?
I got a massive box full of stuff, and to be honest with you, there was very little of my voice in any of it.
So, in my care records, it's like a whole collection of almost the very same thing. Which is like, why can't I see my mum? When will I see my mum? Why can't I see my brothers and sisters? Like, I'd drawn big question marks and written all around them. That's just what these pages were full of.
The only time I could see any of my actual feelings written down, and it's such a standard thing that social workers do with kids, they got me to draw a house with boxes and put my feelings inside the boxes.
I don't think the children's hearing system is doing its job. No. I think we're having to take some decisions which we know are not in the long-term interests of the child.
That was it. That was all of my voice I could find in a stack of care records.
And that is pretty much what I'd written from my entire time in care. And I would get to see them, but it would be like once a month. And sometimes not for months. And never together.
Most decisions are being taken simply because of some of the circumstances you're faced with them. Or the lack of resources, or whatever.
They were letting us all see my mum at the same time initially. Once a month, for an hour. Like, supervised contact. And what they'd written about it was we were all, like, trying to get her attention. And all, like, competing for her attention. So it was unhealthy. And she couldn't display good parenting skills in doing that.
Some of the language used about children and their families in reports is shocking. I am honestly appalled by how some of the reports are written by social workers.
I had a really good social worker at one point. Chantelle. She was really nice.
The children's hearing system is supposed to be the place where the voice of the child is heard, but it really doesn't work that way most of the time.
I always say care is something that happened to me. I wasn't involved in it in any way.
How do you find the voice of the child then? There has to be some mechanism that lets us do that.
Don't get me wrong. I really got on with my foster parents the majority of the time I was there, but I was a really damaged, vulnerable young person. I was exhibiting behaviours of a breakdown and I was just crying out for someone to make it all right and make it better. And you can see it in my care records, but for some reason that wasn't clear.
And when I needed someone to advocate, Chantelle would definitely advocate for me.
Through an advocate? Through the child recording what they want to say to us in some form beforehand? Because at the minute, what did we have?
And so when I was 16, it was decided to move a mother and baby placement into my foster home. There was a decision made that my needs were no longer as important, and so suddenly everyone's attention was on the baby.
And when I got my care records, I would see that she'd noted I would always be asking to get moved from my foster carer because they weren't doing any of the things for me that I could see them doing for their own kids. I was just another foster kid on a conveyor belt, one in, one out.
And so I started to lash out, not at other people, at myself. Went through a period of really bad mental health. trash my room one day.
Not treated like a member of their family, but more like a parasite.
And instead of comforting me and trying to find out what was going on, my foster dad told me to leave and never come back.
And I could see in the records that Chantelle would know that I wanted to leave. But there was a senior social worker who'd be like, no, no, he needs to stay where he is, stability and all that, let's keep him there.
And because I was 16 when my foster placement broke down, social work wouldn't find me another foster placement, and they said they couldn't find me a place to live.
So, someone higher up in the social chain always undermined the opinions of the person who actually knew me and knew my situation.
So I was put into a B&B and I ended up being there for around a year. People didn't even think about how crazy it was to have me in that place. I was saying it really explicitly, you're putting me at risk. And I remember really vividly sitting one day with my social worker outside the community centre and explaining to her just how much of a risk it was for me to be there left by myself. And she just started crying and said, I totally agree with you, but no one seems to be listening. No one seems to be doing anything about it.
What does listening to a child or young person actually mean to us adults in the system?
And so I said it to my counsellor. I need help to tell people that this is all of what's on my mind and it's making it really difficult for me to stay in an insecure B&B room on my own constantly.
There are two different ways of listening. One is passive listening, where someone is sitting in front of you talking. And the other is active listening.
So my counsellor wrote a letter to the head of the social work team.
Too many adults in the system are defensive. It's easier to defend your position than it is to reflect on your position or change your position.
And it was only then that they magically found me a flat.
Because if you do anything other than defend yourself, you're flying in the face of the way that the system expects you to operate.
The only thing that made anything change was my counsellor, a professional voice speaking for me. I couldn't say it for me. And the consequences of that are massive. It makes you doubt your own voice.
Joanne, 40s, foster carer. I used to see adverts from families for children looking for more foster carers. Earn 30,000 a year working from home. It's not a fucking job. It's more than a full-time job. It's your life. You're sharing your life with a child. And they're sharing their life with you. Me and my husband, we've got three boys in our family. Two brothers and then a third boy came to us about 2 years later. Just on respite for the weekend and here we are, 8 years later. When the first two boys, the two brothers, first came to live with us, I was sending pictures to social work every day, as these wee weans were knocking shite out of each other in the living room every night. And it was all just through anger and frustration and abandonment and confusion. There was a lot of discussions, especially in the early days, about separating the brothers. But I was instrumental in keeping them together. Because I knew they needed each other. So we walked for miles every night, put their coats on and would go for a big walk and a talk after their tea. Because they didn't like looking into your eyes, you know, when they were talking to you. So that's what we did. They all came with very different presentations of their trauma. Comes in waves. And I always say, you have to give these kids time to work through what they need to work through so they're able to accept your care and your love. They're not always able to accept care at the start because they don't trust it. And they're doing that just because they haven't had unconditional love at some point from someone who cared for them. You have to try your hardest to hold on to them until they're ready to be loved. I'm really determined with whatever I do in my life. I have to help the boys prevent them doing the same thing, you know, happening again in their families. So I definitely see myself in their lives for the rest of their lives. I want to be like the granny to their kids and help them with support and material things. If they wanted it and welcomed them in, I wouldn't feel bad if they chose to go back to their parents. If they found a way to hold their families together, if they welcome me into their future, I'll be there. I use the word love all the time. I can't imagine what it would be like if you didn't unconditionally love the children you were looking after and caring for. How would you endure some of the difficult things you have to go through with them and watch them go through? What quality of life are you giving them? But the system allows people to come into the role of foster carer all the time without testing if they have the capacity to give that unconditional love. They don't even ask people this question when you apply. Why not? As their parent, I love the boys unconditionally, and I tell them that, and I voice that openly. But I don't expect them to love me back, and I think that's really important. You can't enter into this world of looking after young people if you're looking for them to love you. You should have your cup topped up by your love for yourself. And your love from your friends, by those who sit around you, knowing that at times your cup will be drained dry. Love for me is an emotion. It's also a commitment, and it's done by action. It's what I do.
Kathy, 40s, placements officer for a local authority.
My job is to improve outcomes for children in care while reducing costs.
My bread and butter is to find young people who aren't engaging in education and to find a way for them. I work with Kaylee.
No one with half a brain would do this job because I'm under constant pressure about the budget. I'm not a social worker, but I do understand the drive to improve outcomes for our children while spending money effectively.
We return children to the council area where they were born and where they grew up.
The problem was we had too many children being sent out with the local authority, being privately cared for in residential units and being schooled.
And often we ship off our most vulnerable kids, those who are being most exploited through county lines or sex trafficking, rather than those who are exploiting them.
And they were so far away, they lost contact with everything they know, their community, their family, their sense of identity, even their accents were different.
We bring our children back home because it is the right thing to do. It is about identity. So, for example, we have a young person here who was excluded from school and they were shipped off to the Central Belt to a residential school. Effectively, we were saying, we can't care for you or cope with you, so we're packing you off. We then found out that we were paying thousands of pounds for this young woman to get care and an education, but she was spending most of her time sitting outside the classroom in this so-called specialist unit. And when I found that out, I was like, are you actually kidding me on?
Our fire in our belly, our total commitment comes from the profit being made by private care companies. We had someone look at the accounts of some of these companies in Companies House, and what some of the directors of these companies are earning is... Yet, most of their frontline staff are on minimum wage. And are these companies making outcomes for our children better? A few are, but most are not. How can a single placement cost £250,000 a year?
One of the ways in which we most fail our most vulnerable young people in Scotland is education.
But then that means we need to give them the very best care right here. I've been allowed to be very creative, to have very free rein. I need to work across systems, housing, health, education, social work.
We are still not fulfilling the values for the curriculum for excellence because school is not for everyone. It doesn't bend.
That's an almost impossible thing to do sometimes.
And there are kids who can't fit into school because of poverty, dynamics within the house, and trauma. A lot of our young people in care get bounced out of the education system because they don't have the soft skills to manage it.
We have two boys who've been out of our area for 4 years. We bought a house, made it an actual home, not an institution, and brought them back.
We need to understand whether we are a teacher, a social worker, or a counsellor. It's love. That's what we are doing when we work with these young people.
The staff were told these kids will be tricky initially, but you have to stick with them. You're the long-term carers. We didn't employ anybody who didn't completely see that as how the house was going to operate, and they're all still there. That tells you something, doesn't it? The staff don't move.
Love is attachment, attunement, an ability to notice and respond to a child's underlying needs, being emotionally available to them.
Their previous care provider said they couldn't cope with school or much else, to be honest. Within a week, they were both in a local school.
That's what we're asking our staff to do. That is what we are training our staff to do.
Within a couple of weeks, the school phoned me and said, Elliot, one of these boys is way, way more gifted than they were ever given credit for in the last 4 years. I was raging. A million quid in fees to this private care provider to not find that. What are they doing? Anyway, those kids are thriving now.
We have to be human beings and see them as human beings.
I wouldn't say everything we do is the answer for everybody. But we'll keep working to find all the answers. These are our kids, and they belong here, with us.
They are our kids, and we need to hold them like we would hold our own child.
What if?
What if rather than criticise the poor and how they carry their burden, we stood back in awe?
What if we realised that we're all connected to each other?
What if we held each other the way we'd like to be held ourselves?
What if? What if the people of Scotland really
What if we start thinking about those kids as our kids?
What if we did compassion?
Nurturing.
Providing.
Acceptance. Saying no sometimes.
Compassion. Being there. What if we thought about attachment?
Mentalisation. Really seeing me, doing fun things with me.
What if we made an effort in
bringing out the best in me? Reassurance is so important.
What if Scotland's care system was really about understanding how I feel?
Making someone a real part of your life.
What if we did that?
What if we all realised it takes a whole village to raise a child?
What if?
What if?
What if?